the middle. Then it started to hook just a wee bit.
We've got a lot of great lead-in songs here on Sports Talk, but this by far my favorite, leading us into the final segment of the week. It is time for Birdies, Bogeys, and Biceps all across South Carolina, brought to you by our good friends at Tsunami Bar, as we welcome aboard George Bryan off a strange, to say the least, day two of the PGA Championship. We're also going to be joined by Clemson head women's golf coach Kelley Hester, whose team went out today and shot an 8-under par in the opening round of the NCAA Division I Women's Championships. That's got them right now a one-shot lead over Northwestern South Carolina, by the way. Well off the pace, they are at plus six, sitting in 20th position. We'll get to coach in a moment, but first, let's welcome George up on the 10th tee. We'll go alternate tees here tonight. George, how are you on this Friday?
Oh, couldn't be better, and what a beautiful day, and what a privilege it is if we can get our national championship leader after the first round on the telephone. We 2 weeks in a row, and amazing. I tell you what, she and Coach Kalen with the game, they crushed it, just crushed it, hit it out of the park their last visit to the tee box, and it'll be a lot of fun talking with her. And, you know, the Tsunami Bar was invented in the Clemson weight room.
Yes, it was.
And that is a fact. How about that? Back in 2011, 2012, David Abernathy with Gordon Brown, well, David Abernathy was the assistant too at the time, Coach Joey Batson, and Coach Batson's still there. And that's, we're talking the strength and conditioning coach for the football team. But the bottom line is the Tsunami Bar was invented in the Clemson weight room, and it's certainly magical. There's nothing like it out there. It's the only fitness product that you can actually have a lot of fun while you get your fitness and strength and conditioning work done, and that's a fact. And so the now getting it done, it's only the first round, and we'll cover a little bit with the PGA before we bring Coach Hester on, but first round of many to come. It's a marathon out in California, but now I know it's a lot of golf news going on, and probably get the let's go ahead and get it up. Let's hit it, and then let's move on, because I know what you want to talk about.
So, considering what Scottie Scheffler dealt with this morning, to see him go out in major championship conditions and shoot a 66, is that one of the greatest rounds of golf you've ever seen?
Well, I actually didn't see it. I was watching it a little bit over the internet, but with a man like that, and all things considering – and I don't know, I don't have any of the facts, didn't see anything, didn't watch interviews. I've kind of shut down on stuff like that, just to be honest with you. And I'll let that story unfold. It's tragic. Absolutely tragic. Yep. This is a man of character, and I can promise you he was heartbroken as anybody would be. And it's just a tragic situation. Now for them to keep on going with the event, you know, that's, I guess this world just keeps going, but it's absolutely horrible. And with somebody like Scheffler, although, you know, it's what he's used to doing, he's just got to keep going, got to try to get past it somehow. How? Obviously he did. And there you have it. It's the best. That's all I know.
Love it. Well, then, that being said, let's talk a moment or two about the leader. Speaking of great rounds, Xander Schauffele sitting at minus 12, shot a 62 yesterday. There are four rounds of 62 in major championship history. He's got two of them. And just the job he is doing, and where did this come from? I'm not sure Schauffele was one of the guys you looked at and said he's going to contend this weekend.
Well, I actually, no surprise at all. I watched him even prior to getting to the PGA Tour a pretty good bit, and really impressed with him long before he got to the Tour. And he's a young man of solid character, and he comes from great stock, hard worker, and no surprises after what he did last week. He went a little bit – he played good golf, but the best player, maybe one of the best players for sure in the world, just got really hot. And it's when one of those type players, a Rory, when they light up, it's just a different caliber. So no surprises. And that's one of the things that it'll be fun talking to Coach Hester, and can't wait to get her on the tee. When you're rolling hot, things are going good. One of the fun things about the game is how do you keep it lit up? And Shoffley, no surprise to me. He went a little bit, I wouldn't say flat, but even par's a good round at Quail Hollow as he did last Sunday. No surprises that he just absolutely caught fire today because he wants to win. And it would not surprise me at all if he just kept the pedal to the metal and won his first major right there in Louisville.
All right, well, let's welcome her on the tee to join you here for this round of Birdies, Bogeys, and Biceps. The head women's golf coach at Clemson University. The Tigers went out today. All they did was light up the scoreboard a -8 to -80, and they presently hold the lead after one round of the D1 Women's Championship in Carlsbad, California. And Coach Kelley Hester joins us now here on the phone lines. Coach, first off, congratulations on an outstanding performance by your team today. Great round. Congrats on that, and welcome back into Sports Talk.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Yeah, the girls, we had that 6:40 a.m. tee time starting on hole 10. I think the backside's a little bit more challenging than the front side, but we're still learning this golf course with this really just being our second time practice round and then today day one, but really proud of our effort today for sure.
Beautiful, Coach, and what a privilege to have you again on. You all crushed it, hit it just out of the park last time we spoke, and y'all have kept the fire going. A little bit to help us out, those listening, would you talk a little bit about the setup of an NCAA championship? I know we have a major championship on TV now, and you can see a good bit of the grass differentiation on the TV, and talk a little bit about how NCAA sets up the golf course, if you would, and how you all are reacting to it.
Yeah, sure. So we're playing at Omni La Costa golf course here, where they've had a bunch of PGA championships through the years. And but it went through a total redesign, and we were the first people to play it in 2 years. Not knowing exactly how a new course is going to set up, they're not playing it as long as they might otherwise because of new greens being somewhat firm. And I think to combat that, the green speeds are a little bit slower than what they might normally be at a national championship, just so they don't get so firm that we can't hold them. But we go 3 days of stroke play, and then they cut to the top 15 teams, and then an additional day of stroke play, cut to the top 8, and then we go to match play. So it is definitely a marathon week. You know, we had a really good first day. We're excited to get a good night's rest. It's good to have that early tee time. And then we're the first afternoon wave tomorrow, so we get a nice good rest in there. But it's a marathon, and we still have a lot of teams out there on the golf course. So, it's great to get out there and shoot a good round. One of our South Carolina girls, Isabella Rawl, had 8 birdies today, shot a 66. She's no stranger to golf in South Carolina for sure. But on the national scene, she's really making a name for herself this week.
Well, she is also – she's got some experience. I would – categorize her as one of your veteran players. She happens to be from right here in the Midlands. Watched her grow up, an incredible game, and comes from a great family. In the last year or so, I've had a chance to speak with her grandfather a bit and talk a little bit about Isabella and your players. And it's obvious y'all are playing good, but talk to us about where your players are in experience in the game and maybe some of your expectations as you take off into the week.
We have one senior, Annabelle Pancake, on our team, and she played great today. She shot a 3 under 69. Bells was, she comes from a golf family. Her dad is the head golf pro at Crooked Stick, there in Indiana, where John Daly won his first PGA championship. He may have won, I don't know if he won more than one, but he definitely won his first PGA championship there. And, she's just been really steady for us. She was a finalist at the British Amateur last summer, got to play in the Augusta National Women's Amateur. Just a really a rock in our lineup. And then we have three South Carolina girls, Chloe Holder, Isabella Rawl, and Sydney Roberts. Chloe has been the one or two player on our team the better part of the spring, but had a rough day today. So no doubt she'll bounce back tomorrow. And then Sydney Roberts from Chesney, South Carolina, shot two over today. She had a quad on sort of a tricky hole, one of the ones where the, you know, the golf course's teeth really came up and showed us what it could do, but bounced back and made quite a few birdies and was really strong to get us in there with that two over par. And then we've got Milena Barrientos, who's from Texas. She shot one under par today. And really any of our five players could be our best player for the day on any given day. So we have some depth there, and just really proud of this group and excited to see, you know, how the rest of the week unfolds for us.
And so in your estimation, if you compare stroke play, and that's the first three rounds you mentioned, it will be stroke play, and then the top eight teams advance. Is that what I heard you say?
Right. So, well, you go four rounds of stroke play, and then it goes
four rounds.
Match play. Yeah, they cut to the top 15 after the third round, and then to the top eight for match play. So, yeah, you just have to hang in there strong enough to get into that top eight, and then, as we all know, in match play, really anything can happen.
George, if you don't mind, I'd like to follow up. George, if you don't mind real quickly, I would love to follow up with Coach on that. When you're coaching your team, and obviously you play a lot of tournaments that are stroke play, what is the challenge? Let's assume you guys, and we certainly hope you will, advance to the match play rounds. What are the challenges that your players face going from where, you know, every shot counts to maybe going to a situation where every hole counts and it's an entirely different setup?
Yeah, I would say our team loves match play. I think they feel like they can play freer because if you make a mistake, it might cost you a hole. But, mm-hmm. you know, in stroke play, obviously you make a mistake, it could, you know, you could have a quad or a triple or, you know, whatever. So our MO with this particular group, that we won the ACC championship last year. We didn't get to finish this year's ACC championship. It was Wake Forest and won due to darkness. That last round. So they have played really well when we've had the opportunity to compete in match play, and then some of the summer golf that they play in match play. So I like our chances if we can get into that, you know, top eight, but there's certainly a lot of golf to play to get there.
Okay, George, thank you. That. You can take back over.
No, great question. And, you know, some of the folks, they're different mentalities. You have a chance as a coach. You have a chance to maybe take a different strategy. Walk us through some of your preferences in a match play strategy. And I know I don't want to get too far ahead. I know where I know a little bit about it, and you first just have to get there, and your work is just getting started with three more rounds after today. Are you one that would shift strategies as the event becomes match play, or do you maintain a little bit of what got you there? And that is a strategy. It's still stroke play. Even match play is still stroke play. Whoever has the best number on the hole, will that player win? Talk a little bit about yours, please.
Sure. Yeah. Well, I would say each one of my players really is their own director as to how they want to attack a golf course. And Annabelle and Isabella both hit it pretty far, and so they're going to take advantage of their distance the best they can. And then Sydney, Chloe, and Milena are you know, pretty straight hitters. This golf course has a lot of heather, like right off the fairways. That's probably one of the main defenses of the golf course, and so I think that's why we have a good balanced team here, because we have two kids that can bomb it and we have three kids that are going to keep it in play. Part of it depends on who you're playing and how your game matches up with who you're playing in those match play situations. But we really just kind of let the players decide how they want to go about it, and then we support them with what they're the most comfortable with in that situation.
And the golf course, you like how it sets up overall for your team?
I do. It's not terribly long, and so those three players that hit it straight, they're going to be able to give themselves a lot of opportunities. And the distance, there's a couple of holes where the distance can really help you. Like Isabella almost reached a par five today that I would say 95% of the field wouldn't be able to reach. But the way this golf course is designed and the yardage that we're playing it, there's not a huge advantage in stroke play for the longer hitters. So for her to go out there and make eight birdies, kind of the hard way, so to speak, for a longer hitter, she couldn't reach any of the par fives, like actually get to the putting surface in two. So I think that speaks really highly of where her game is right now.
For those out there listening, maybe really familiar with golf, college golf is quite different from college, let's just say basketball, football, baseball. You as coaches, unlike these other sports where they are refined to the sidelines, you get to walk right out with them. Certain spots, I know the rules have changed slightly since I watched closely my children play golf and other students, but talk a little bit about, as a coach, what the parameters, you can go out and get right up close while your player's in the game, even go through and help them make decisions. Is that the same for stroke play as a match play? Talk a little bit about coaching and what your parameters are, what your scope is, you and your assistant.
Yeah, sure. So we're allowed to have two coaches coaching during the round. And so early in my coaching career, we weren't allowed on the greens or in the bunkers. Now we've pretty much freed all of that up. But we talked the night before about where our players would like the coaches, if it's, a certain hole or a certain spot. And we just sort of plan our day and leapfrog. My assistant and I, Katie Nam, who's also a South Carolina native, she played at Coastal Carolina back in the day. But so we just sort of, try to get ahead of one another to get to the next spot where we need to be. And so we don't really get to watch a string of holes. We really are just kind of trying to get to a certain point and seeing players at certain places in the golf course. And really it's more just to, help them make a confident decision. Very rarely do I tell a player like, no, I don't think you should do that. Or, Isabella, we call it a trump card. Every once in a while, she'll say, I'll give you two trump cards around where you can step in and say, I disagree, or this is what we see here. But most of our work is done in the practice round, and we'll adjust that throughout the tournament based on weather conditions and whatnot. But we really just try to get a good handle on where they want us during the round, and then we try to be there for them, make sure that they're fed and hydrated and have what they need.
And coach, I'm kind of pushing you around a little bit. It's been years, but I'm familiar. You're a coach that you're the players coach, and you allow, and actually it sounds like you promote a lot of independence with your players.
Yeah, absolutely. Golf is a game where the player has to hit the shot. Nobody can do it for you. And so I want to empower them to make the best decisions they can. And so we talk about, it's just like parenting. You want to work yourself out of a job, right? Like you want them to not need you or feel like they don't need you and that they can make those decisions yourself. And I now have a 17-year-old daughter, and we're sort of trying to teach her how to make good decisions as well. But part of that's the fun of coaching, and players learn from making mistakes at times. And those are sometimes the best lessons learned. And so in a safe environment, we try to encourage them to come to the best conclusions they can. And then we chime in when we need to. But that's one of the things I enjoy most about coaching. And I do try to pride myself on being a player's coach.
Well, that's one of the things that, and there are a whole lot, they're different styles. My term I would use is ownership. I love to see the players go out and they own their own game, and usually accountability runs right along with it. But I'm going to ask you a blunt question. Do you see yourself calling an audible with any of your players in situation, in the most meaningful situation? Do you envision that?
Yeah, occasionally we do, but it's typically not new information. Normally, it's something that we've talked about in the past. But like I said, we'll throw a trump card in there every once in a while if we feel really strongly about something. But it's hard to do something based on what somebody else tells you if you don't really buy into it.
Yeah, that's one of the most intriguing parts of the game, and it would be the what we're discussing. If for those out there listening, it'd be a little bit like a pitcher shaking off the sign he or she would get from the catcher, and you see the shake, see the head nod. But when I ask you about the audible, would you stroke play versus match play? Is there any more or less involvement from you and your assistant, Coach Katie, standpoint?
Well, I do think that's where a player might ask our opinion. Like, does it make sense to go for it here? Does it make sense to do this, that, or the other? And so usually they're just looking to us for some confidence there. I'll typically be, you know, pretty honest. But my standard question when somebody asks me to read a putt or, you know, this is my number, what do you think? I'll say, well, what do you think? What do you see? How do you feel about it? We run into those situations if the team has a chance to win a championship and if you want to be more aggressive or not. But for the most part, we do encourage them to play their own game.
Well, and there is, as far as the transition from stroke play to match play, there aren't any rules changes as far as how it affects coaches, is it?
No, not at all.
And it's unique. Golf, to me, extraordinary. Unlike some of the other sports, you got soccer field, football fields, softball, baseball, basketball courts. They all pretty much look the same. But golf, every course is different. Every hole, every course is so much different. And you got so many different ways to play the game, so many different personalities. And anything else you want to share? Because it's really a privilege to have you on after the first round and spend all this time. It is 3 hours behind, but anything else you'd like to share with those listening, Coach, about your team and the upcoming week?
No, I just, you know, all those Tiger and Gamecock fans out there, I would say that our two teams have a tremendous amount of respect for one another, and that's one of the great things about this game of golf. But I did also want to give a shout out. Coach Abernathy was a strength coach at Furman during my 4 years there when I was a head coach before my time at Clemson. So you were talking about the tsunami bar, and I got to know Coach Ab and use that tsunami bar during my time at Furman. So I just wanted to give him a shout out there too.
Well, you know, I'll tell you, I love this man. He is, just first, he's a man of character, a man of God, and he absolutely is passionate about his sport. I do appreciate you mentioning him. He's it's a privilege for him to be the leader of our team, and it's I'm glad he transitioned to come to work at Tsunami Bar Sports. I will pass along, and if he's not listening, he could easily be listening. And what a way to close it down. That's what I call making an eagle on the last hole, and it'll be a lot of fun.
Indeed.
Y'all get plenty of rest, and look forward to watching this tournament unfold. So thanks a lot, Coach.
Thank you, Coach. George, outstanding stuff. We appreciate Kelley Hester from Clemson jumping on board. They're off to a terrific start, and you handled it very well. Good to chat with you again on a Friday. We'll talk to you next week.
Team, I shoot them low.
All right, buddy, be good. That's George Bryan, also Kelley Hester.